All right, good evening. My name is Bob Ehrman, and I'm a new member of the Fiction Subcommittee for the Book Festival. And I'm very excited and honored to be here tonight to introduce our speaker, Maggie Ginsberg. We come in appreciation and praise of books. Thanks very much for attending. Before we start, though, I have a few logistics. First, I need to read a statement. We want to give thanks to the many individuals, businesses, and public and private organizations that have donated funds and services to make the festival possible. Please check them out in the festival newsletter. They're on the very back page. Go and check them out. We invite you to help with next year's festival by contributing to the donation jar that you'll find out at the book sale table. Second item, please avoid having your favorite new ringtone bring scorn and shame upon you by silencing it now. So get in there and turn that off. Following the presentations and questions, we will ask that everyone exit the room. And even if you are registered for the next session, you can leave your belongings if you wish, and you are registered for Shelby Van Pelt. But you'll come back into the door, and they'll check your name off as you come in. It's a privilege to introduce Maggie Ginsberg. Maggie has been a writer in Madison, Wisconsin for many years, and now has worked her way up to senior editor of Madison Magazine. She's done hundreds of interviews and published articles in a wide variety of publications. Recently, though, she switched from nonfiction to fiction with the publication of her first novel, Still True. I'll hold up mine because this is the newer copy. Still True, hopefully everybody's had a shot at this. It's a great book. I really enjoyed this book. It's a remarkable piece of fiction that's set in a Midwestern town. The characters seem like people that we might know. The town seems like a place that we've been. And I just think the situation that these characters got themselves into was super interesting. And I remember the first time I read through it, I got about 10 pages to the end, and it's like, how is she going to finish this whole thing up in 10 pages? She managed to do it. Still True has been nominated for several awards. A personal comment, I spent my career at UW-Eau Claire and got to know colleagues from all over campus. One colleague was an acclaimed writer of murder mystery novels set in a real city out east. When I read books set in actual locations, I frequently refer to a map to figure out where they are and where they're moving to and from. And when I read his book, I noticed that there was the layout that he described in the book was different from my map. And I mentioned this to him, and he said to me, oh, you're one of the map guys. I often hear about map discrepancies from them, but the worst are the gun guys. I have to be super careful when I make any gun reference to make sure that the gun function, the way the bullets behave, the way they penetrate or ricochet is exactly right, or the gun guys get on my case. That's just a small sample of the role of truth in fiction. And I think that many fiction books, as well as nonfiction books, could be said to be based on a true story. I'm really looking forward to hear what Maggie has to say about this important topic. Please give an enthusiastic welcome to Maggie Ginsberg as she presents her talk entitled Hiding in Plain Sight, Embracing the Truth in Fiction.
Thank you, Bob. It's like you were reading my notes there. I'm definitely going to talk about that, and we can talk about specifically nonfiction to fiction, in the question and answer part, because absolutely that is something that I've been thinking a lot about, clearly by the name of the talk, but also just something I've been thinking about all year since this book came out. So, it's really special to be back here. Still True came out on September 27th of last year. And on September 28th, I was right here in this room. Your celebratory week of the grand opening of the library in this brand new amazing space was the same week that my book came out. And the Chippewa Valley Writers Guild was kind enough to invite me to come. Your Nicholas Butler was kind enough to be my conversation partner. Everybody came to see him, including me. I didn't care. I was just absolutely amazed that I had a book out into the world and that this was happening. So it's really neat to be back here. I kind of wish I still had a conversation partner, but it's okay. I've got this. And I'm gonna talk a little. I'm gonna read a little. I'm gonna talk a little again, and then I'll make sure that there's plenty of time for Q&A. But don't worry if you don't have any questions. I can keep talking forever, so no pressure. So Still True is a book about a couple, Lib and Jack Hansen. They've been married for 28 years. They've been together for 32 years, but they have never lived together. They live in separate houses, 2 miles apart in fictional Anthem, Wisconsin. There's also a younger family in the book that has just moved to town, and that couple, Claire and Dan, have a 10-year-old boy named Charlie, and he kind of bicycles his way through the book and becomes particularly close to Jack. But Claire is a main character as well as Lib, and Claire is unhappy and sort of floundering and insecure in her parenting and drinking a bit too much. And none of these characters are me, and everything is made up. And this is the end of my talk. Thank you for coming. So as Bob mentioned, Still True is not just my first book, it's the first fiction I've ever written. And I never thought that I would write a novel, even though that is my very favorite thing to read. I just didn't think that that was the kind of writer I was. And even my nonfiction work, I came too late. I didn't publish my first article until I was 30. And so I spent all of my adult career trying to learn as much as I could about the craft and the business of nonfiction writing, while sort of ignoring the craft and the business of fiction writing because I didn't think it applied to me. I didn't think I could learn that. I thought that authors had these magical unicorn brains with ideas just shooting out of their ears that they couldn't keep up with, and that they were born in author town and grew up eating author Wheaties and then published their author books because what else could they do? And so long story short, a series of events in 2017 opened my eyes to how ridiculous that was, and I came to understand that I could give this a try. And I wouldn't have to be burdened by the facts of like I am in my day job, and I could just make everything up. What fun! And you know, looking back, this line of thinking is a little suspect, because I mean, part of that series of events was learning that there is just as much structure and there's just as much scaffolding, you know, when it comes to constructing fiction. Obviously. Of course there is, and there's also, I would argue, as Bob hinted at, an even higher bar for truth in fiction. Fiction has to feel real, or you will lose the reader. And we can talk about that more later, but the point is I've spent a lot of my life thinking about how things feel and interviewing other people about how things feel. And so what really shifted for me was that awareness of like, oh, if I just think of these as real people out there in a real town, then I just need to interview them like I do in my day job, and I just need to research the town like I would in my day job. And I can give that a try, and I can write these stories about families that I like to read, and how freeing. But I still meant other people in other towns, not me or my loved ones or my family or my neighbors or everyone that I've ever known or been, which is, spoiler alert, is kind of accidentally how it turned out, which is a little bit mortifying. But back to 2017, I thought, okay, I'm gonna make up some people, and they could be anybody, and they could be anywhere. But it's probably gonna be a small Wisconsin town, right? Because, I mean, write what you know, and I've only ever lived in small Minnesota and Wisconsin towns. But the last thing I'm going to do is write about a recognizable small town while living in a recognizable small town. So, Anthem. And I Googled it, and it doesn't exist. Unbelievably, because we've got Arena and Avoca and Argyle and Albany and every, you know. But I saw it very clearly in my mind. I had a map that I drew that I kept next to my writing desk, and it was very real to me, and it wasn't anywhere I had been. It was different. It was on its own. And I saw the people, the characters, first. And Lib Hansen is the first character that I saw, and I saw her with her silver braid, and I saw her at her farmhouse table up on the rise. I saw that it was a working farm. It was no longer a working farm. And I saw that she was alone. I saw that she was fiercely self-protective and private and independent and strong. And so I thought, okay, then she's not married, clearly. And then my next thought was, wait, well, why does that have to be one or the other? Why is she either this strong, independent woman or she's married? And so right away I knew, okay, she is married. He just doesn't live there with her in her house. And, you know, so I knew that that was a possibility because I am in a second marriage and for 10 and a half years had not ever lived with my husband, but that's neither here nor there. So I just knew that it was a jumping off point, right? We had had all of these conversations about what really makes a marriage beyond the opportunity to share an address. And we got all of the questions that Lib and Jack get. And so I knew that this was not us. This is other people. Jack is, you know, this handyman, mechanical thinker, black and white thinker, really loves the truth. Really loves knowing how things work. Has this cat named Tinker. He's in his 60s. You know, my husband, you know, is a bicycle mechanic and has a garage full of tools like Jack does. But my husband has two cats, and Jack has one. And we had, honestly, we have very different, we had logistical reasons for why we were doing what we were doing, and we were an hour apart, not 2 miles apart, and all kinds of things, right? I could, very different. And so with this story, I knew that something had to come between them, or else there's nothing to do in the book, and I knew that whatever came between them had to be different than the usual stuff that comes between you. And I don't just mean the fighting over the dishes in the sink, but I mean how when you have a real partner, you know, they're in your face, and when you're not your best self, they know it, and they can call you out, and they can hold you to account. And I felt like in Lib and Jack's case, you know, if things got tough, they could just retreat to their own houses until they were back to their best selves again. And so what would come between them? I knew that it had to be something that challenged them both on a values level. For Jack, it seemed obvious to me that that would be something having to do with the truth. It was clear to me then that Lib must be hiding something. But I was really interested in, I didn't think of Lib as a liar per se. So I was interested in why, what she was hiding and why, and what, why she was so self-protective. Because what would challenge her on a values level wouldn't just be, you know, the keeping a secret, but it would be, you know, her reasoning for keeping the secret would also need to be challenged, that values piece of it. And so I understood what it was that came between them, and I wrote the first scene that for this book that is still the first scene that is in this book. And so I think that I will read a little bit from the beginning, not the whole first chapter, but we'll read about what comes between them and then we'll talk about it. Lib Hansen could have made the walk to her husband's house by feel and sound alone, her eyes squeezed tight against the Wisconsin dusk. 3 decades spent wearing a path between their separate homes made it all seem a part of her. The cool, slim trails of wet grass across her bare ankles as she cut across her yard, the dip of the ditch and the slipping pea gravel edging the county road, the chemical crunch of city-sprayed thistles already forcing themselves up through the cracked asphalt at the plastics factory where they'd worked for ages until its sudden closing 2 years back, the way the air shifted ever so subtly once she hit town proper. Jack preferred driving the 2-mile stretch between their houses, but Lib almost always walked, regardless of weather. On rare occasions, they walked together. She'd asked Jack once if he could feel that change in climate on the trek between their houses, rising now like bated breath, cleaving her nightgown to her calves and thighs, her skin still sticky from the fear triggered by tonight's surprise visitor. No, Jack had answered. I think that's something you made up in that glorious mind of yours. Jack always told the truth, no matter if it stung. Poisonous anxiety surged through her as she darted past the rows of warehouses at the edge of Anthem and the newer, jumbo cookie-cutter houses tacked onto this end of town like an afterthought, down to where the green ash and white oaks hovered over the older, more reasonably sized homes tucked closer together. Her guard had been down. She hadn't seen it coming. But now she felt the recognition sink in sharp and deep like a bone ache, as if the cancer she'd never had had come back. 2 hours earlier, she'd been in the back garden getting after the ruined tomatoes. No matter how she coaxed, those tomatoes did what they wanted, creating a gangly, sprawling, bloody mess. Year after year, the alleged annuals returned and insisted on their boneless tantrums, breaking free from their protective cages and hurling themselves vine and fruit to rot in the dirt. This spring, fed up, she'd winnowed them down to just 2 starter plants, 1 sandwich a day, the occasional dinner salad for Jack. But last year, stragglers had spread, and now they pocked the tidy garden anyway. She leaned back on her boot heels, considering. It was no longer in her to force them into compliance, and maybe that was the problem. Her days of wrestling in things into place were over. When the slow crunch of tires on gravel broke through her reverie, she couldn't quite place the sound. First, she thought it must be the mail carrier bringing a package to the house that was too big for the mailbox at the end of the long, curved driveway. But her favorite old postman had retired last year, and these new kids never bothered. Anyway, it was practically supper time, the mail long done. She pushed the rope of her silver braid over her shoulder and listened, caught a flash of a firefly in the shrub rose thicket on the periphery. A child on a bicycle wheeling by on a stretch of county road that bordered the sloped eastern edge of her property. The faint smell of charcoal and grass clippings, the drone of a mower in the distance, the steady hum of the air conditioning unit. She brushed the dirt from her shins and rounded the back corner of the house, eyed where her driveway met the front porch. Saw the car first, a nondescript sedan, before she saw the man climbing the steps. Instinctively, she froze behind the ancient lilac. He could not see her unless he knew just where to look. He was shaggy-haired, clad in a long-sleeved t-shirt and faded jeans in this heat. She eyed the forward slump to his shoulders as he faced her front door. There was something tweaked about the way he stood, as if his top half was clicked into place just slightly off from his hip sockets. She wasn't a good judge of age these days. They all looked like kids to her, but she guessed he was about 40. And although she couldn't make out the details of his face, even at this distance, she could feel his grimace. Steam rose in curls off the paper cup of coffee he held, and his other hand was raised as if to knock, but it didn't move, as though whatever had paralyzed her had gotten him, too. He stood staring at her front door, too hesitant to be a traveling salesman, too casual to be someone needing help. She knew she should call out a greeting. Her resistance seemed more than the simple desire to avoid small talk with a stranger, something older. Just as his knuckles grazed the door, his fist spread instead into a splayed, flat hand. He pressed it there for what felt like a full minute, an almost tender palming of the door at eye level. What was he doing? Silly old girl, she thought in Jack's motor oil and molasses voice. No such thing as a stranger when a man needs help. She tucked her head into her shoulder to wipe the sweat from her lips and was about to take a tentative step forward when the man stepped back and pitched the coffee cup at her door, where it exploded in a dark spray. He hopped down the steps and strode to his car, slammed the door, fired the engine, and swung the vehicle around, spinning out in a cloud of choking dirt. Lib held her breath until he disappeared around the gravel elbow of her driveway, skidding down the hill and out onto the road. Toward town, then, she thought, after she could no longer hear the angry squall of his motor. She waited there, beside the lilacs, a long time to come back into her body, not unlike she used to when things got bad. There was something in the way he'd thrown the cup, as if she were expected to pick it up, as a baby might with his mother. The awareness was already starting to tug at her, his familiar hips, his age, his fury. She started again toward the house, slower this time, hesitant, keeping her head down as she shuffled through the ryegrass and clover she left long for the honeybees, dodging the ghosts that had begun to drift across her mind. She imagined Jack instead, his blue eyes squeezing into a smile behind the pottery coffee mug he favored, the fine gray hairs that had begun to sprout along his freckled shoulders, the particular gold the maples had blazed 28 years ago to match their rings on their wedding day. When the worn soles of her work boots hit the gravel marking the edge of the driveway, she let her gaze drift up the porch steps. She was hoping that she'd made the visitor up. But it was all still there. Blood rust coffee stained her screen door, pooled in the cracks of her porch planks. The crushed paper cup trembled in the evening breeze. She sprang into action, hosing the coffee from the chipped blue door, from the faded brown planks. The prairie coughed up a wet wind, spraying seeds, blowing the porch swing, tickling the dampness at her hairline. Stooping to gulp from the cold, clean stream of water flowing from the hose, she braced as a fresh fear walloped her. If her visitor was who she thought he was, it was all over. She wheeled off the spigot, wound the hose away, and went inside to scrub the dirt from the whorls of her fingerprints, fixed a buttered turkey sandwich she left untouched, reheated a bowl of soup she forgot in the microwave, put on her nightgown, went through her usual routine, but triple-checked the locks. It was too early for sleep, but she tried anyway. Shut the blinds against the summer suppertime sky, climbed into bed, and pinched her eyes closed, pressed her hands to her face, her breasts, her belly, curled her body into a fist, but it was useless. And there was only one other thing she could think to do. She rose, went back downstairs, pulled her barn coat over her nightgown, slipped on her sandals, and set out for Jack's. So I'll stop there, but that, I'm not giving anything away here. This all happens in chapter one, but we learn that 40 years earlier, this is the baby that Lib abandoned 40 years earlier, and there was a husband that Lib abandoned, and Jack doesn't know about either of them. And she makes a decision in chapter one that she is going to continue to keep this a secret from Jack. She believes that she will lose him and the life that she has worked so hard to rebuild. And she believes that it is not anyone's business, including his, this life that she has sort of stuffed away and moved on from. And that's her decision making. And so now I had enough personal interest. I had questions, which I think is where every story starts, is with the characters and the questions. And my first question was, why not just tell him? And so that was really interesting to me that she wasn't going to tell him. And I wanted to know why Lib was denying herself this comfort. And what do you do when you're going through the biggest thing that you've maybe gone through and you don't feel like you can go to your person? What does your marriage really mean then? How close really were they? Did they have the intimacy she thought they did? Was she as independent as she thought she was? Could she have both independence, true independence, and true intimacy at the same time? What is the true cost of self-protection? What counts as lying? Where is the line between privacy and secret keeping, or between secret keeping and lying? What happens when you think of something that happened to you instead of an actual person out there in the world who has his own set of self-protection and motivation and messiness and anger and resentment, just like we all do. Not me, all of you guys. And so that's where it began, with those questions. And I just really wanted to know how it would go for them. So now I'm going to tell you another story about my life. And I'm going to tell you two things. One, I have my mother's permission to tell this story, so don't get too nervous. I know it makes some people nervous sometimes, so now I say that up front. My mom knows I'm going to tell you this. And number two, none of what I'm about to say is in this book. So it truly this time, none of this is in this book. And it's a story about a secret that was kept in my family that I didn't know about until I was a teenager and probably would have never known about if it had had a different outcome. And that is that in the 1960s, when my mom was a 15-year-old girl on the tobacco farm in Edgerton, Wisconsin, she got pregnant by her older, not good guy boyfriend. And her choice was to either marry the older, not good guy boyfriend, or to be sent away to the Salvation Army home for unwed mothers in Milwaukee, 100 and some miles from home to live until the pregnancy had disappeared and the baby was given up for adoption. And so that's what my mom chose. And so at 15 and 16, she went and lived for months with other 16 and 15 and 14 and 13-year-old girls who had all been sent away from their communities. And they would they gave birth. They went through the, you know, the trauma of pregnancy and giving birth. And then they would allow the girls to hold the babies once before they gave them to the adoptive parents. And my mom didn't think that she could survive that. And so she hid in a supply closet and she painted a painting until she knew they had taken the baby away. And then she went home to never speak of it again, just like they all did. And they went home to communities where nobody knew what had happened, but everybody knew what had happened. And it also just wasn't addressed. It wasn't like, then mom went to therapy, you know, it wasn't, it was just a thing and you just moved on and you didn't talk about it. My mom met my dad just a couple years later and she did tell him. And I often think about how different things would have gone for her if she hadn't. But fast forward 23 years, and that baby was now a grown woman named Julie, who had been raised by wonderful people and wanted to find her birth mother. And so she found my mom, and they were instantly close, and they still are. And they just had this really wonderful reunion. And the painting that my mom painted hiding in that closet now hangs in my sister Julie's house. And it was, you know, lovely. And now mom had some explaining to do. And because of that experience, a lot of other people came out of the woodwork, you know, mostly privately to tell her of their similar experiences. And in many cases, they were still keeping those secrets because they believed that they would lose the lives they had now, what they had built. And part of it is, I think, that particular time and that particular place. But I just sort of, you know, grew up all thinking about these things with this all around me, just thinking all the time about all the different complexities on all sides of things and being really aware of just how much was going on that wasn't, you know, being talked about and might not ever be talked about. But like I said, none of that's in this book. There is no adoption. There's no home for unwed mothers. There is no happy reunion story. But when I realized that I was thinking a lot about all of this, I went to my mom and I said to her, you know, I've been telling this really personal story about you. Like, I did, you know, I didn't realize that this is what I was writing about. I really didn't. And I really didn't, because I know I didn't, because I was giving my mom every draft of this book as I was writing. Like, look, mom, look at the cool thing I wrote today. And my mom was reading it going, oh, that's nice, honey. And never once was I going, huh, I wonder if this affects her in any way. And so when I really kind of realized, wow, I'm really writing around these things that I never thought I would write about because it didn't seem like my story to tell, I said, you know, I'll stop. You know, tell me to stop and I'll stop talking about this. And she said, no, I like it when you talk about it. I like to hear you tell this story. I like to hear the empathy that you have for Lib. And when I hear people at your events express that same empathy for Lib, I forgive myself a little more. And I just, I get emotional every time I do this, sorry. For one thing, A, forgive yourself for what? And for another thing, which would be B, you know, still, almost 60 years later, I can't math, you know, and a happy ending, a happy outcome, and you're still carrying around this level of shame and guilt. And so that just really, I just carry that with me. That was a really unexpected part of this whole thing. And I do continue to check in with her. And the last time that I checked in with her about this, she said, look, if you need it to be even, if you need it to feel even, when you talk about Claire, your character Claire Taylor and her drinking problem, I feel more empathy for your drinking problem. And that is my mom's gentle way of telling you the next really personal thing I'm about to tell you that I absolutely had no intention of writing into a novel. And that is Claire Taylor. One of her main characteristics is that she has a problematic relationship with alcohol. And what my mom is making it even by telling you is that I, too, had a problematic relationship with alcohol. And I was able to get some help and quit drinking in January 2010, so just about 14 years ago. And I will tell you that in the first many versions of this book, Claire did not have a problematic relationship with alcohol. It wasn't part of her storyline. Claire came about when I was thinking about who Lib was from the outside. How did she appear to the people in the town? And I thought, well, it depends who's doing the looking. And I bet that Lib looked pretty good to a woman who felt like she had the opposite of what Lib had, who didn't feel like she had a good marriage, who didn't feel like she was seen by her husband, who had a child she felt insecure about. And so Claire began to take shape for me. She no longer had a job outside of raising Charlie in her home. And yes, that job had been as a journalist. But that just, you know, it just made sense. And, you know, she's 10 to 15 years younger than me, has a son. I have two daughters. She has straight hair. But as I mentioned, in the first many drafts of the book, Claire did not have an alcohol problem. She had a lot of problems, but drinking wasn't one of them. The story was the same. The plot was the same. The floundering and the questionable decisions and the attraction to this guy she's seen around town who she doesn't know is Lib's returned son, because nobody knows. All of that was still there. And 6 months into the book being out on submission, when my agent was trying to get a book contract, she called and she said, all of these characters feel fully formed to me, but there's something missing with Claire. Do you know what it is? And I was like, no, she's done. It's good. The book is done. Sell the book. And she's like, no, I feel like there's something just not quite there with her. Could you take another pass through it? That's how they say it. Take another pass through, like you're tiptoeing through your book, like with that in mind, and see if you can figure that out. And so I did, and I studied it, and I talked to a friend. I had a friend read it, and I thought about it. And when it hit me, like, oh, she's an alcoholic. It was so exciting because it was like, oh, it makes so much sense and it's going to be so easy to live. And then I was like, oh no, she's an alcoholic, and now I have to go there and I have to write this stuff. And I did, and it was the right decision, but it was simultaneously the easiest and the hardest thing that I ever did with this book. And even then, I was so close to it that I didn't see that a theme had emerged. I thought I had just solved the problem of Claire. But what happened is that bringing her relationship with alcohol out in the book the way that I did, it also then made more obvious some of the other characters who were also dealing with addiction or alcoholism, as so many of us are. And all of a sudden, it was everywhere in the book. I ended up publishing with the University of Wisconsin Press, and part of their process is that they send the manuscripts out for peer review when they're deciding whether to publish something. And one of the peer review reports came back talking about calling it an important book about alcoholism. And I went, oh no. Oh no. And then I made the mistake that I make all the time of being honest in the first interview that I ever did for this book. And so once you say a thing, you cannot unsay it. And so then that was a thing that that was then talked about all the time. When this came out, the journalists picked up on that. There was WPR even did an article with statistics about Wisconsin's drinking culture. And yes, there were many times that I wished that I could kind of go back. Okay, now I know what it's like to write a book, and now I know that people are actually going to read it, and then I'm going to talk about it, and I'm going to find something different to say about it. But then I started to meet people, and I started to get messages, and a lot of them were from particularly women with the same sort of drinking challenges or questions, or the same sort of adoption or abandonment or things like that. And then it became something I no longer regret, and it's something that I'm grateful for. And it has helped me understand better, you know, what my own book is about, if that makes sense. And again, Claire is not me. The specific things that Claire gets up to are not the same specific things I got up to. And Lib is not me. And Lib is not my mom or any of the other, you know, amazing women that I've had the privilege to know. But my best friend read this book and called me. And this is before it was out. And she called me and she said, "I just feel like I read something really private." And I was like, "What do you mean? It's fiction. I wrote a fiction book." And she's like, "Yeah, no." She's like, "I get that you are none of these characters, but you are all of these characters." And I went, "Shoot," you know. And that is that's the stereotype, right? That first novels are notoriously autobiographical. And maybe I'm just sensitive to it, but it feels a little condescending, right? This idea that it's boring or kind of a rookie move, or it's navel-gazing, or you're just more blatantly obvious about it and you call it auto-fiction. I still don't understand genres and labels and book marketing, but why wouldn't we use what we know emotionally? Like, you know, and that's why I read. Like, that's how we get at the heart of the messy human condition and just how weird it feels to, like, be alive on the planet. And, you know, what could be more important than writing about how we connect? And I don't know about you, and I know this is oversimplified, but I think there are kind of two kinds of readers. You know, I either read to escape or I read to feel seen. And obviously there's a spectrum in between and you can be both, but for me that's the crux of it. I'm either reading to completely forget my life and try on someone else's for a while, or I'm reading to feel connected and more understood and less alone. And if there weren't authors writing about these things, then I wouldn't know that I'm not the only one who, you know, struggles with drinking or any of the other things. I recently had the privilege of spending a week up in Bayfield with in a writing workshop with Pam Houston, and it was amazing. And she talked a lot about the role of the subconscious in our writing, and I love the way she described it, because she described the subconscious as what you don't know you know, which I don't know why no one's ever put it to me that way in 48 years, but boy, did that hit. And I'm still figuring it out, but it's more than just, you know, simply, oh, I thought I was writing about Lib, but I was writing about my mom this whole time. And it's more like the way that Lib presses on her body all the time, and then having a trauma therapist read the book and tell me that that's a self-soothing trauma response. Like, if I've ever been taught that, I don't recall. You know, it was just what Lib does. It was who Lib is. Or someone else telling me that Charlie, the 10-year-old, exhibits classic signs of a child of an alcoholic in the way that he protects Claire and takes care of her. Well, how could I have written him that way on purpose if I didn't even write her as an alcoholic? And so I think that there are all of these things that are always floating, you know, between us when we're reading, when we're just communicating with each other, and we don't always know what they are. And so, like, lo and behold, the most specific personal things to me that I didn't even know I knew that I was putting in here are the things that other people have connected with and connected with me with. Every talk that I've done, someone tells me something that that is from their life that they wouldn't have told me if we hadn't, you know, had this, if we didn't read. And so that's why we read. That's why I read. That's why I write, you know, to be in community with you, to be a better neighbor, to nurture this empathy, to be aware that every single one of us is walking around with all kinds of stuff we're not saying, all kinds of stuff we don't even always know, to give you the benefit of the doubt in hopes you'll give me the benefit of the doubt. And I just think that's how all of our interactions are. I think they have to do more with us than each other. And you never know what someone else has lived. And the fact that my mom can gain empathy for herself 60 years after the fact just because I wrote a book and then talked about it with people, like, you know, that's wild. And I think it matters. So I think that's a really good place for me to stop and invite some questions. I nailed it. I can see that clock. 40 minutes, they told me. Right? That is... thank you. Thank you. Yes. Franny and Kit, the two waitresses who never ever come up, who nobody asks about. Sure, you know, so Franny and Kit are the daughters of Carolina, who was Lib's best friend and who died 10 years before the book starts. And her cafe, Cafe Carolina, is where the waitresses live and work. And they've just kind of kept the cafe going, and it's where everybody goes to have family dinners once a week. And honestly, I'm as curious about Franny and Kit. I mean, I saw your bookmark. I know you're only halfway, so I'm not going to ruin anything for you. But I think there's more to know about them too. Yes, there are other characters in the book. I spend a lot of time talking about Lib and Claire, but, there's a community, right, that is implied in those characters, I think. They sort of exemplify it. And for me, it was that trying to get at that feeling of life in a fishbowl, which can be really great. I mean, there are really good things about a small town. And there are really challenging things about a small town. And how, you know, how we take care of each other or don't, and how we choose our family, they are a part of that, I would say. Thanks for asking about them. Yeah. Yes.
I wanted to ask, so first of all, I want to say I really love the book.
Thank you. Thank you. So for me, the hardest part was, I mean, I actually kind of like everybody. I like a lot of problematic people. I don't know. I really, I don't struggle with that as much, not even in books. But I did struggle as I was writing. The question is about how to write, you know, how to deal with unlikable characters. There were many times I did not like what these characters were doing. And to me, that's the distinction, right? But the people that I love, they're not always behaving well. But I still love them, even when I don't like them, right? But since I got to be the boss in writing, I was like, well, you know, I kept wanting to nudge them in the right direction. And Jack in particular, when the truth always outs, right? So when things, you know, go kind of sideways, I wanted Jack to behave better. There were lots of times that I was like, come on. But what I have such an appreciation for now that I didn't necessarily have before is, and this goes for every book, but this decision that an author is making in every single book to like parachute into a specific place at a specific time, and just this really, this compressed moment in time, right? And you have to start the story somewhere and end the story somewhere and parachute out. But there's a whole bunch of lives that have been lived up until that point and that will continue to be lived after. And so figuring out who people are in that moment, not who you want them to be or how they are going to be later or who they used to be, and trying to stay true to that is part of, I think, that accuracy in fiction. And so sometimes that means that people are just not getting it right. Now, I was worried. So for real, I realize I have no credibility here, but Dan, Claire's husband Dan, is not my ex-husband, whose name also starts with a D. He really isn't. They really are nothing alike. But obviously, I was worried. I called him like 5 times. I was like, so I ended up writing this book, and it's going to come out, and people are going to think that I'm the drunk in the book, and people are going to think this awful husband is you, and it's not. He's like, it's fine. I'm never going to read it. I was like, fair enough. But then my husband, my current husband, read the book, and I knew everyone would think that he was Jack because of all of these reasons that he's not. And he hates what he hates. I do not have his permission to tell this story. He got to the end of the book, and he goes, you know, I like all these characters, but I think the one I relate to the most is Dan. Right? And I was like, what? He's like, yeah, I think I'm a Dan man. So you just don't, I don't know. This is the same man who, okay, so we were living an hour apart. We went out for pizza when I was drafting this book. And I said, so if I were harboring a 40-year-old man in my basement, like hypothetically speaking, how long do you think it would take you to notice? Like, serious question. And he did not stop chewing his pizza. He did not even look up. He's like, I don't know, a month, maybe? So I'm not going to take, you know, take his word with a grain of salt. Does anybody else have a question?
So you said you read to either be seen or to escape. What books do you love to read?
I know. You know, it's the books that make me... It doesn't have to be the exact circumstances of my life, right? But it's the ones that make me feel like I have felt. So I love Nicholas Butler. I mean, I always have. I love Carol Dunbar. Hopefully you're all coming to her panel on Saturday afternoon. Honestly. Have been singing the praises of The Net Beneath Us. Those are the books I love. You know, I grew up reading, like, especially my parents' books. I always read all of their books and all of the Ann Tyler books. Like, I was reading Ann Tyler at 10. Like, I don't know. You know, all those books. I love Barbara Kingsolver. I love Anita Shreve. I love, I don't know, just, like, stories about real people. Like, I think it matters. I think we matter. I don't know. I'll get off my soapbox. Yes. Sorry. The question is, will there be another book about Anthem? I don't think that I would ever write a sequel, because I don't want to be the one who decides what happens to these people, much in the same way that if I spent an hour with you getting to know your life, I then wouldn't want to say, and here's what's going to happen to you, because to me they really did become like real people, and I just kind of want to respect their lives. I know that's weird. But I am curious about Franny and Kit and some of the other characters. Poor Jack has a best friend whose funeral he's just come from in chapter 1. Lyle, oh, I want to know what's up with Lyle. I want to know why Jack doesn't talk to his family that lives only 15 minutes down the road if Jack's such a likable good guy. So I just think there's more that I would maybe be interested in, you know, looking back at from before. But I don't think that I would want to be the one who says what happens to everybody, because I don't know. They're still out there somewhere. And that would be rude of me. Yeah. Yes.
I've heard authors explain their writing process. One group will say that they think of a character, that character becomes very real and then directs the story. And then the other group of authors say, no, I'm directing them completely. It's me in the driver's seat.
Hmm. The question is about characters directing the story. I wrote this story chronologically, and they all took turns, and it just sort of, came out the way it did really quickly in the first draft. Thank goodness, because I've been working on a different book that has not been that way at all. And for me, it really wasn't about the plot. But the characters' emotions were driving the plot. So I was keeping track. I had this nerd chart. So like across the top was the timeline of the story, but down the side was each of the characters, and for each of them, four or five things about their belief systems and their emotions that I was following. And so at any given moment, I knew how each of these things was changing, but also like how it was changing against each other. And it was in those moments, so if you go on my little graph, like, 73% of the way in, this person believes this the most, and this person believes this the most, so put them together, what's gonna happen? That's kind of what was driving it. So I guess to answer your question, it was a community, affecting each other, that where the story came from. I don't know if that answered your question. Yes. Did the ending surprise me? I can't give spoilers, so there are some things that changed about the ending right before we went to print. So not about what happened. What happened was always what happened, but about who knows about things that happened. And that surprised me. And there were lots of things that surprised me along the way. There's a, without giving any spoilers, there were many moments that I was surprised where I just didn't know. All of my revision for this book was never about changing the story. It was always about deepening the characters. It was about solving a story problem where there would be some case of, I don't think this person would say that, or I don't think this person would do that, so what's going on? Kind of like the example of with Claire, it was a really big thing, but there were smaller things along the way. And so that's where all the surprise was for me. Lots of surprises. Yeah. But you can ask me later about what you want to ask about, what the specifics are of the ending, I'll tell you. Anybody else? Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm so superstitious, I can't say. I will say that I think that people in small towns using lying as problem solving and life in a fishbowl and getting up to no good and everyone believing that they're doing the right thing is probably my beat now. I think that might be what I just don't get sick of thinking about. And I don't get sick of thinking about how we are in relation to each other, and specifically in a partnership, what we hold other people responsible for, what happens when those people aren't there anymore and we're still us. Those are the things I spend a lot of time thinking about. So that's kind of there's a epigraph in this book is from your own Michael Perry, from a Michael Perry song, And it sums up what I think about all the time. And that lyric is, "You hurt me long before you knew me, and I did the same thing to you." I could think about those two lines all day. And I think that's what's going on in this book, and I think that's what I'm still trying to get at in my work now. Yeah. Yeah.
Just a mechanic question. What's your writing schedule?
I wrote this book between 5 and 7 a.m. every day, and then I went off to work. So it was something that felt a little bit detached from my life, and it felt kind of surreal. It was also the winter time, and so it was dark. And so it was like 5 to 7 a.m. Nobody needed anything from me. Nobody was emailing me. Even the dog wasn't up yet. And it was just me. And then real life would start. That thing just, you know, would flip in my brain, and I would go off to real life. But the next day when I sat back down, the stack of paper was just a little bit higher. And that's the only way to do it, I think. Is to touch the work every day. She said to herself. Yeah. How am I on time? I can leave you with one last lighter thing since we got so heavy. My husband is a creative writing major, actually, unlike me. And it is ridiculous because he does not ever read books and he does not write. And I asked him, why did you get a creative writing degree? And he said, and I quote, "to get chicks." And I hate that it worked. And he is a bicycle mechanic, and so I relied on him heavily for all of the bike things in here. And when he read the book and decided he was a Dan man, he said, "You know, I wrote page 17. And I was like, "No, you didn't. I wrote a whole book. Like, can we just give me this?" And he's like, "No, I wrote page 17. And I was like, "Okay." And then we found the texts. So I'm going to read you this text exchange from January 20th, 2017, at 7:04 in the morning. So I must have just finished with my 5 to 7 a.m. for the day. And I texted him, "Yeah, I also need you to describe to me the perfect bike for a 10-year-old boy. And if it had a flat, would a regular jack-of-all-trades have a tube lying around?" And he texted back, "No." "A jack of all trades would have a patch kit tucked in the back of a drawer. He'd be pleased with the fact that the glue was still soft. He'd remove the inner tube and overinflate it and listen for the hiss, then scuff the rubber around the hole with sandpaper, wipe with alcohol, apply glue, and smooth the patch over the spot. Then wait, the hard part. Gotta let it cure or the patch won't hold." And I, it's documented, texted back, all caps, "Nice." And then he texted, "Charlie should have a BMX bike." And he texted, "He wouldn't have a tire hanging around, and if they bought a tire, they'd buy a tube. A guy like Jack will always fix rather than replace, so keep it simple and allow him to fix stuff." And I said, "Perf." I'm just going to read you a short part of page 17. This is the part where Charlie has just showed up to Jack's garage with his flat tire on his, yes, BMX bike. And he asks if Charlie's in a hurry. And Charlie says he just doesn't want to be stuck. "I hear that," said Jack, rising to the old dresser he'd mounted on casters, fashioning a mobile set of junk drawers. He pulled the top one open and dug around until he found the patch kit, pleased that the glue was still soft. He worked slower than he usually would have, conscious of Charlie's eyes tracking his every move. Jack pried the tire off, pulled the inner tube loose, and overinflated it, listening for the telltale hiss. Once he found the hole, he scuffed the rubber around it smooth with a worn square of sandpaper, wiped the surface with alcohol, and carefully, expertly applied the glue before sliding the patch on. The waiting is the hardest part, said Jack, eyeing Charlie again. Gotta let it cure or the patch won't hold. I'm now obligated to read that part at all of my events. Thank you. You guys have been great. Thank you so much for having me.